couple of weeks before Lent actually begins, we always hear this beautiful parable of the prodigal son. And it is an amazing, amazing parable, which you can draw so much out of it. And we hear about a father who asks his son, an older son and a younger son. I am the younger son in my family. And the younger son says to the father before his time, he says, Father, give me half. Whatever is due to me when you pass, so give me my inheritance now. And as I said in Greek, and I've said other times, to the child, it is like saying to the father that he is already dead. So to the child, his father is already dead. You can imagine the pain and the sorrow of the father when he hears his son do so. Tell him or ask him, give him half of his due. But the father, being a righteous man, a loving man, gives to his son half of his inheritance now, before he has passed away. And the son goes off and lives a life which is not a good life, but not a good life. And he spent all of the money, all of his inheritance, and was left with nothing. And as he was sitting in the mud, because he was feeding swine, as he was hungry, sitting in the mud, lying in the mud, he thought to himself, I've done something wrong. I've done many things wrong, and I'm going to go back to my father's house. I'm going to apologize to him, and I'm going to ask him not to restore me as a son, but to restore me, put me in as one of his servants. Because even his servants, he is such a good person, such a good man, that even his servants eat more than I do, and even more than even these pigs do. Because he was willing to eat the food of the pigs, because that's how hungry he was. So he gets up, and he goes back to his father's house, which was many, many miles and miles and miles away from the distant land. And he goes back. And as he's walking through the house, his father sees him from a distance. And his father quickly runs to him. And as he's running to him, and he hugs him, and he kisses him, and he welcomes him, and he cries, and he's so happy to see his son. And his son says to his father, I have sinned before you, and I have sinned before heaven. Please restore me, not as a son, but please make me just a servant in your house so that I can be close to you and I can have something to you. His father, which is very interesting, in the gospel reading does not respond to him. He doesn't say like we say, let's see what's going to happen. Or he doesn't say, my son is back with that sarcastic tone and we do not nod our head. My son is back, look at him. I guess he's going to make it up there. I have another servant. He says to the servants behind him, he says, bring the best clothing that you have and the ring. The ring is a sign that you are my son again and you are restored to your rightful place. You were dead and you are alive. The father celebrates. Not the other son, the older son, who never left the house. Who never left the house and never left his father's side. All of a sudden is coming back from the field. And he says, and he hears that there is a party going on because the father says to the servants, kill the bad calf and let's have a party. Let's have a great feast because my son is alive. But the older son didn't know that. He's coming back and he hears this party going on. He says, my father is left with me and there's a party going on in the house. Obviously my father is losing his mind. What's going on? And so one of the servants comes out and tells him that his brother is alive and has come back. And his father not only has welcomed him back as a servant, but has restored him again as a son. And he will not win. The older brother, who is there every day, has access to the house, who is in his father's house all the time, surrounded by the goods of his father, will not go back in the house. The father comes out. He says to him, why are you not coming in? He says, because I never left your side. You never killed a lamb for me to have with my friends so that we could eat and have a joyful time and have a great feast. He says to him, my son, everything I have is yours. You've been with me the whole time. Everything I have is yours. And the son says, you will not go back. What does that mean to us? It is a beautiful parable that shows us first that the father never, ever asks us to leave the house. The Father, who is God, never ever asks us to abandon the kingdom or to leave the kingdom. Even when we want what is not rightfully ours yet, we take it and we run and we squander all over the place. Even then, the Father doesn't say, take it, get out of here. gives it to us. He says, go and do what you want to do. And then when we come back, he welcomes us back up instead of giving us that attitude that you and I would have in one of our churches. And not only does he welcome us, but he restores us back to our right place. Nor does he ask the older son to stay out now or to get away, but he invites him back into the kingdom, back into the home. And unfortunately, the son, because of his ego and his jealousy, refuses to go back into the kingdom or into the father's home. It is we who choose to leave the Father's house. It is we who choose to leave the kingdom. It is we who choose to stay out of the kingdom when we are invited back in. It is us, we, who have to make the decision. Our Father, the Lord God, always. Our Father, the Lord God, always welcomes us back. And he always wants us to be in the kingdom. And he will be at the door of the kingdom. And not only at the door of the kingdom, he will send his son. He will run to us. So that we can have the kingdom. He will sacrifice his son so that we can have the kingdom. We'll do whatever we can so we can have the kingdom. We, sometimes, because of our ego, stay away from things, and we are unwilling to go into the kingdom and be surrounded by God's glory. As we enter in a couple of weeks, Lent, we come close to Lent to be some beautiful parables. Think of how we sometimes maybe are indignant about how someone who is a sinner comes into the church and receives God's blessing and God's grace. Because we are ignorant. We are so big. We are so loving. We're so orthodox, but we're so unwilling to welcome back someone.